Jazakumullah khairan for attending the fourth sessions of the life in the barrier or the life in the grave. And yesterday we started the topic of what can we do to benefit our beloved family and friends who have passed away before us, in the hope that we can, one, benefit them, and two, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send other people for us when we die, they can help us as well in our other life in the barrier. And we said there are 9 things we can do to help the dead. The best thing, as we said, to pray janazah, and this is the best thing ever you can do. The second, to stay behind for a little while after the burial of the body, to allow for the accounting time, etc. 3, to make dua immediately after the burial. This is the best time to make dua. You can make dua at any time until the end of your life, but the best time to make dua for the dead person is immediately after the burial. 4, to make dua and istighfar all the time. And 5 is charity. And we said after Salatul Janaza and making dua at the time, the best thing you can give is charity for their soul. And we mentioned some details. One of them is to make the niyyah clear that it is for the sake of X or Y. 6, which we'll cover today, Salah, Sawm, and Hajj. Prayer, fasting, and making Hajj. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said, a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, O Messenger of Allah, my mom died and she has not fasted for a month. Shall I do it on her behalf? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if your mom had a debt, would you pay it on her behalf? He said, yes. He said, the debt of Allah should be paid off as well. So if you are aware that your mom or dad or family member, whatever, they should missing some days of fasting, then you should do it on their behalf. Narrated by Al-Bukhari and Muslim. Also, Ibn Abbas narrated that a woman from Juhayna came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, my mom made a vow to make Hajj, but she died and she didn't fulfill her obligation. You know, if you make a vow, it becomes compulsory in you. If you make nadr, you make it becomes compulsory in you, even if this Hajj is not Hajjat al-Islam, even if she has made her own Hajj that she should do. She did it once, but if she made a vow, it becomes compulsory. So he asked the Prophet, this woman asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, shall I make Hajj on behalf of my mother? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Hijji anha. Make Hajj on her behalf. And he said the same, if your mom had a debt, would you pay it on her behalf? You have to pay the debt of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Narrated by Al-Bukhari. And another hadith narrated by Ad-Darqutni, that a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, O Messenger of Allah, I used to make birr to my parents in their life. Make birr, I was obedient and I used to do good for them in my life, in their life. Now they died. So how can I do good for them after their death? كَيْفَ بِبِرِّهِمَا بَعْدَ مَوْتِهِمَا. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, among the birr that you can do for them after their death is to pray for them with your prayer and to fast for them with your fasting, and you pay charity for them with your charity. Yeah, so when you do good deeds, do something for them as well. So this is Salah and Sawm and Hajj. 7 that we can do for the dead people is recitation of Quran, to recite Quran. Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq in Fiqh al-Sunnah said, the consensus view of the scholars that recitation of Quran reaches the dead people. And Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal said that the dead person benefit from all types of good deeds that we can do for them. And as we mentioned so far, we mentioned charity, we mentioned dua, we mentioned sawm, we mentioned hajj, we mentioned prayer. So Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal said the dead, all the good deeds, all types of good deeds will reach the dead person because of the nusus, the evidence, as we mentioned before. And Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal said, Muslims at all time used to gather and recite Quran and send it as a gift for the soul of their dead people. And this is a consensus of all Muslims. The scholars who say that recitation of Quran reaches the dead person, they make a condition that you shouldn't pay someone to do it. So if you want to recite Quran for your cousin or your uncle or your mom or your dad, you do it. Yeah? Or fine, but you don't hire someone, you pay him money to do it. This is not acceptable. That's what the scholar said. Al-Imam al-Nawawi said that the madhab of Imam al-Shafi'i, that recitation of Quran doesn't reach the dead person. So this is the opinion of the madhab of Imam al-Shafi'i. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim said that the worship are two types. The worship are two types, either financial or physical. Financial, to pay zakat, this is financial. To pray or to fast, this is physical. Hajj is both. Hajj, you have to have money to spend, and it is physical. Yeah, so these are the two types of worship. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim said, if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam approved that charity will reach the dead person, this means any type of worship that is financial will reach them. So Imam Ibn al-Qayyim understanding is, this is just an indication from the Prophet. If the charity will reach the dead person, this means all types of financial worship will reach the dead person. And also, if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam approved that fasting will reach the dead person, then all types of physical worship will reach the dead person. And this is just an example. And if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam approved that Hajj will reach the dead person, and the Hajj is combination, it's half financial, half physical, it includes both. This means any type of worship that includes both will reach the dead person. So this is Imam Ibn al-Qayyim summary. So to summarize, all types of good deeds, according to the consensus view of the scholar, will reach the dead person. Charity, dua, istighfar, recitation of Quran, Hajj, Sawm, Salah, prayers. Number 8 to help the dead people is to visit their grave. To visit their grave. Aisha radiallahu anha said, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no man visits the grave of his brother and sit next to the grave, but he will, I will read it in Arabic first. ما من رجل يزور قبر أخيه ويجلس عنده إلا استأنس به ورد عليه حتى يقوم. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, no one visit the grave of his brother and sit next to the grave. إلا استأنس به. استأنس به, you know, when you have someone in your company and you sit together, you don't feel lonely because you have someone with you. This is istanasa bihi. ورد عليه حتى يقوم. When you say السلام السلام عليكم, he will say وعليك السلام. There's another hadith as well عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنه said, no one passes by the grave of his brother believer that he used to know in this dunya and give him salam, say السلام عليكم. He will know him and will say وعليكم السلام. And another evidence, Aisha radiallahu anha, this hadith narrated by Ahmad and Al-Hakim. Aisha said, I used to enter my room and take off my clothes. You know, Aisha radiallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is buried in the room of Aisha. You agree? Prophet, when he died, buried in the same room where he used to live with Aisha. Then when Abu Bakr died, was buried next to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as it is now when you visit the Prophet. Then when Umar died, he got the consent of Aisha radiallahu anha to be buried next to his friends. So came Prophet Abu Bakr and Umar, as when you visit the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Prophet Abu Bakr, Umar. So Aisha saying, when the Prophet and Abu Bakr, her father and her husband, she is living in the same room. So she used to say, I take off my clothes, easy, in her own room. But when Umar, a stranger, is buried, she said, now, when Umar is buried, I never enter my room, but with my full clothes on. Yeah? Shy that Umar is there. So this tells you, this is an evidence that tells you that death, as I said to you, is another type of life. Yeah? So Aisha, because Umar is there, you might say Umar is dead. Yeah, but this another type of life. See the understanding of Aisha. But as I explained to you yesterday, this doesn't mean that you go beyond Nusus and you try to invent your own practice. That's what make people get it wrong. Yeah, don't go to a grave and say, oh, they are living. Aisha radiallahu anha said, she feel ashamed to take her clothes off because of Umar's presence. So I will go to that person in the grave and ask him help because he is a righteous person or whatever. Yeah? So we follow what we have been told. Don't go beyond because this is ghaib. This is unseen. We don't know. We know what we know. So don't go beyond it. Is that clear? Yeah. Also, hadith marfu'a narrated by recorded by Al-Bayhaqi عن Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said about the martyrs of Uhud, أَشْهَدُ أَنَّهُمْ أَحْيَاءٌ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ, I bear witness that they are living before Allah. فَزُورُوهُمْ وَسَلِّمُوا عَلَيْهِمْ, visit them and give them salam. فَوَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لا يسلم عليهم أحد إلا ردوا عليه السلام إلى يوم القيامة. By whom my nafs in his hand, no one will give them salam, but they will reply to his salam until the resurrection day. Yeah? And the last visit the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a couple of weeks before he got seriously ill and died, he visited the grave of martyrs of Uhud. Number 9 and last that we can help the dead people is to praise them, mention their goods or good habits or good give, the good that they have done in their life. Imam Ahmad recorded that Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, when the slave dies, people praise him. Yeah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet, I'm reading the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows differently about this grave, this slave. Yeah? So when the slave dies, people praise him. He was good, he was praying, he used to come for tarawih, he doesn't commit the sin, etc. Yeah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows differently about this person. Allah knows the secrets, what people use to do in secret. So, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the angels, I make you witness that I accepted the witness of my slaves on my slave, and I have pardoned my slave for their praise. Get it? Yeah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because a group, big crowd, praised that person. They don't know that what he used to do in private, but Allah knew. But because all of them praised him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pardoned him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful. Any opportunity just to bestow his mercy on the slave, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do it for us. Aisha radiallahu anha said, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, don't mention your dead people but with good. Because if they are entering Al-Jannah, you will be sinful. Because you will be backbiting someone from Al-Jannah and you mentioning bad things about him or her. And if they will be people of the fire, yeah, it is enough what they are in. So don't keep mentioning bad stuff. They are in bad place anyway. Yeah? Narrated, recorded by An-Nasa'i. Also Aisha radiallahu anha said in Hadith al-Bukhari, don't insult the dead because they have gone to what they have done. And Anas radiallahu anhu said, this hadith recorded by al-Bukhari and Muslim, Anas radiallahu anhu said, a janazah passed by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and people mentioned bad things about the person. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, confirmed, wajabat. Then they passed by another janazah, so the people said good stuff about him. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, wajabat, confirmed. Then Umar later asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you remember we passed by janazah and people said bad stuff about the person. You said confirmed. Then another janazah, good stuff, you said confirmed. He said, the first one, you mentioned good, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confirmed al-Jannah for him. And the other one, you mentioned the bad, Allah confirmed the fire to him, and you are the witness on earth before Allah. So when someone is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put his love or her love in the heart of good believers, and the good believers like give good testimony to that person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted. This is something that also we can, one, you can help our dead by doing so, but also you can prepare for your future, that whom you will be in company with. Yeah, the people that Allah will accept their witness. Who are your friends in life? Who are the people that you wish to attend your janazah and they praise you? Yeah, so select the people who will attend your janazah. Select. I have seen some janazahs where you will find the son of the man who died doesn't pray janazah on his father. Probably he doesn't know how to pray janazah. He never prayed, for example. So this is the way he brought up his children. They are not practicing. So when he dies, even his son doesn't pray janazah because he had never done it. Yeah? Who will attend your janazah? Are these practicing people that Allah will accept their witness? So prepare now. This teach us lesson. Any questions? Right, right. Yeah.
Even at the time of burial, and even sometimes when people, men right. and women, go back afterwards.
Right. To pray Quran next to the grave, it is a controversial issue between scholars. So I don't answer fiqh issues, but my knowledge that Al-Imam al-Shafi'i said it is mustahabba, and Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal said لا بأس بها, it's okay-ish. But Imam Malik and Imam Abu Hanifa said it is makruh. So this is my knowledge about it. Two of the four scholars said it is makruh, and two said it is okay. Okay.
Also, similarly, when you're reading the Quran for the deceased person, you have to make the meaning that you're reading for them, or is it just anytime?
Anything you do for the dead person, you have to make the niyyah that it is for him specifically. Yeah. So if you recite Quran for your beloved one who died, you have to make your niyyah that this recitation or this fasting or this umrah is for that person. Yeah. So the niyyah has to be clear, basically. Yeah. Ibn Abi Dunya recorded a hadith mursal that Ad-Dahhak said, a man said, O Messenger of Allah, man azhadun nas. Azhadun nas, zuhd means who is the one who have the most like devotion, or the person who give preference to the hereafter over this life. So what is that? Because people get define zuhd or think the person who have zuhd is the person who wear all the clothes or yeah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave the definition. من أزهد الناس فقال من لم ينسى القبر والبلا. The one who doesn't forget the grave and the decomposition. وترك فضل زينة الدنيا وترك فضل زينة الدنيا. He abandoned the excess of this world glitter and the glory. Don't go excess. Be moderate in enjoying the life of this world. وآثر ما يبقى على ما يفنى. Give preference to the everlasting over the one which is going to perish. ولم يعد غدا من أيامه. Doesn't count tomorrow as one of his days, and counted himself as he may be in the of the people in the grave. So always prepared mentally that tomorrow he may not be here. So get ready for it. Because what makes us get it wrong and forget and do the whole wrong, that we think when we walk behind the janaza that it is his or her. It's not ours. Ours is not come, will not come. Yeah, but it can be anyone. There is hadith, another hadith, recorded by Abu Na'im and Ibn Abi Dunya, although I am not 100% sure about the authenticity of that hadith. I tried to look it up, but I couldn't find it. It's an Abi Sa'id al-Khudri yarfa'uhu to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take the soul of the believer, a slave, the two angels, you know, you have one angel on the right and one angel on the left. This angel, their jobs is to write your good deed and bad deed. They have no other jobs. So now the person died. Yeah. So the two angels go up to the heaven and say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you appointed us to that slave, and now he died. Can you give us permission to dwell in the heaven? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to them, my heaven is full of other angels who glorifying me. But go to the grave of that slave and make tasbih, tahleel, and takbir until the resurrection day, and record it for him. See? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is generous. Although, as I said to you, I tried to locate the authenticity in that hadith. It is narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri and also by Anas radiallahu anhu, and recorded by Abu Na'im and Ibn Abi Dunya and others. I hope it is true. This is authentic, inshallah. It was narrated in one of Athar, and I heard this in a tape for Sheikh Abdul Hamid Kishk alayhi rahmatullah. He said, when the child of Adam is put on the wood plate, on the wood plate for people to carry him for janazah, an angel will call him, O child of Adam, where is your fluid tongue? Why you are silent? Where is your nice voice? Why you shut up? Where is your hearing? What made you deaf? Where is your seeing? What made you blind? Where is your nice smell? What have changed it? Where is your wealth? What made you poor? And when he is put in the grave, the angel will call, O child of Adam, أجمعت الدنيا أم الدنيا جمعتك? You collected the dunya, or the dunya collected you? You left dunya, or the dunya left you? Have you prepared for death, or the death came before you prepare? You came from dust, and you went back to the dust. You came from the dust without sins, but you went back to the dust full of sins. And when people leave the person in the grave and the night comes, brothers and sisters, it will be the first night when there is no dawn, no morning ever will come until the resurrection day. It is the first night for the dead person in which he will not listen to Adhanul Fajr. No one will say, As-salatu khayrun min an-nawm. Prayer is better than sleeping, because there is no more salah and no more worship. The person who will make Adhan for Fajr will be Israfil when he blows the trumpet on the resurrection day. And in the first night of the grave, Malik al-Mulk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will say, Allahu a'lam, O child of Adam, raja'u wa tarakuk, they went back and left you alone, wa fi al-turabi wa da'uk, and in the dust they laid you, wa law dhallu ma'aka ma nafa'uk, and even if they stayed with you, they will not benefit you, wa lam yabqa laka illa ana, al-hayy alladhi la amut. And the only one who is left for you is me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ever living who doesn't die. Imagine, my brother and sisters, when you have been put in your grave and you listen to the voice of Munkar and Nakir, remember, like the thunder and their sides like the lightning, when they call you and make you sit down, they imagine how narrow is the grave. Imagine when they take the coffin off your head to talk to you, and take the cotton pieces from your eyes. And imagine when they look at you with their horrible looking, and they ask you about who is your Lord, what is your religion, who is your prophet, will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love you and make you steadfast, and you say, La ilaha illallah, and my religion is Islam, and my prophet is Muhammad? Or you will be confused and humiliated, and you don't know the answer. The evidence is, when you see them in the good looking and the good shape, you know that you will be saved and you will be supported. But when you see them in the blackish, bluish color that we described in a hadith yesterday and the day before, then you know that you will not pass. Imagine if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you steadfast and you are happy, and they open the window to the fire for you and tell you, this would have been your place if you have not been a good believer, if you have not been among those who attend i'tikaf and have the good company and the good friends, didn't waste time and waste life and committed sins. Then they open the window to Al-Jannah and tell you, this will be your place because of what you have done. This will be your destiny. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, if the dead people have spoken, imagine if any of the dead people whom you know will talk to you now, what they are going to say, what he or she is going to say. They will beg you to ask Allah mercy for them. They will beg you to remember them. They will say, oh you the one who lived in our houses, who got married to our women, or my wife, or my husband, the one who is living in the wide houses or palaces, and we are in the narrow graves, the one who divided our money and the inheritance, oh you the one who abused our orphans, don't forget us with a piece of bread as a charity for our soul or dua, because really we are desperate. When you follow janazah or hear about someone died or attend a condolence, don't think that it is him or her, but you are secure. Who said that any one of us is secure? Every one of us will be carried by men to the graveyard and put there. كل ابن أنثى وإن طالت إقامته يوما على آلة حدباء محمول. It's Arabic poetry. But every son of a woman, and all of us are children of women, will be carried on a wood plate one day. Whatever you do, this is the end. And Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, when he see janazah, he always say, "Imdu fa'inna ala al-athar." You go and we are following you. He doesn't have that feeling that, oh, this person died, not me, I'm going back to work, I'm in a rush. And Al-A'mash said, when we used to attend the janazah, we don't know whom to give condolence to. To give condolence to the family of the person who died or to ourselves. He's saying that because all of us, like, we could be the same person. Like, he feels that he is the person who died, because he will die one day. So he doesn't know whom to give condolence to. To ourselves, because we are following soon, or to the family. And now you see people attending janazah, and they are laughing, talking about the football match of yesterday. I'm in a rush going back to work. This evening I have very important, I'm attending the birthday of my friend. Just they attend just to show their face to the family, that's it, but they don't take reminder of it. And the reason of that, brothers and sisters, is the harshness of the heart. The sins that we do made us forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the last day made that barrier on our heart, that run that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described in Surah Al-Mutaffifin. Kalla bal rana ala qulubihim ma kanu yaksibun. This run, rust on the heart, makes us forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the hereafter. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to leave us in this ghafla, this heedlessness, until the death comes suddenly to us. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes us always awake, always ready, always appreciating the horror of the agonies of death and the grave and resurrection day. The person with common sense, is the one who has that feeling. He knows that he is living in this life for a short while, and they prepare when the day comes, he is ready for it. And imagine if you offer any dead person one day of your life. Imagine, think about it, close your eyes, think about it. a dead person in the misery of the grave, and even if he was a good doer and regrets that he didn't do more, and you are offering from your life one day for him. Yeah, you are offering one day from your life to him. How happy he will be to catch up, or to repent, or pray two rak'ah, or ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness. Because they know, they appreciate the value of the deeds, and they knew the reality. And they regret for every hour they missed. And they want to increase their deeds, even if they are good doers. Imam al-Ghazali in Ihya Ulum al-Din mentioned this story. He said, one of the righteous people, he has seen a brother in Islam in his dream. His brother in Islam died before him. So he has seen his friend who died in his dream. So the living person who has seen the dream, he told his friend who died in the dream, Ya Fulan X, Alhamdulillah, I lived. He's telling him, Alhamdulillah, I'm still alive. That's what he told his friend who died. So the dead person told him, Alhamdulillah, you are able to say Alhamdulillah. If I am able to say Alhamdulillah, I can sacrifice the whole dunya just to say it once. So if he is owning the whole dunya, if he is the best multi-millionaire who is the king of the kings of the dunya, he can sacrifice it to say Alhamdulillah and get the reward of saying Alhamdulillah once. So imagine we have the opportunity and we have plenty of time that we waste on the Facebook and the mobile and watching TV and this and that. That person, he can sacrifice everything to say one time, Alhamdulillah, and dies again. If you know that the death is your destiny, and the grave is your place, and your appointment is the resurrection day, and you will stand before the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your sorrowness should be long, and your desire for the good deed should overtake everything else in your life and your thinking. I will ask you some questions, brothers and sisters. I'm not expecting you to answer, but I'm expecting you to take it and reflect when you go home. Do you pray the 5 prayers on time? Do you pray Fajr on time? Do you recite Quran every day? Do you make Khitam al-Salah every time? You say Subhanallah 33, Alhamdulillah 33, etc. Do you pray Sunnah? Whether Sunnah Qabliya before or Sunnah Ba'diya after the prayers? Or you say it is Sunnah? The companions used to do Sunnah prayers religiously. You know why they do it? You know why? Because it is Sunnah, and they like to follow their beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But we don't pray Sunnah. Do you know why we don't pray Sunnah? Because it's just a Sunnah, it's not fard. So they pray it because it is Sunnah, and we don't pray it because it is Sunnah. We give the same reason. See the conflict, see the difference. Then you will be accounted using the same measure and the same scale as them. Do you concentrate and have attentive heart in your prayer? Or just as a tick box, up and down, just movement, exercise to make your back better because it is stiff. Do you remember death and the life of the grave and the hereafter and the horror of the resurrection day? Do you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-Jannah? Have you ever asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-Jannah? Have you ever asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-Jannah? Be honest. have you sought refuge from the fire? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, hadith al-Tirmidhi, whoever asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-Jannah 3 times, al-Jannah will talk to Allah saying, Allahumma let him enter me. And whoever seek refuge from the fire 3 times, the fire will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma save him from entering me. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enter al-Jannah. Allahumma let us all enter al-Jannah. Allahumma let us all enter al-Jannah. Allahumma let us all enter al-Jannah. Allahumma save us all from the fire. Allahumma save us all from the fire. Allahumma save us all from the fire. Do you have, brothers and sisters, time that you recite a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? When last time you recited hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? You opened the 40 hadith book or any book for a hadith, and you recite a hadith to learn your deen and to have the company with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Have you done that ever? When was the last time? A month ago? A year ago? A day ago? Today? Ask yourself. You will go through the agonies of death. You will go through the barrier life, as we described. These are the preparation. I'm just giving you something to think about. Did you think to get away from the bad friends and also only to keep around you the good friends who can remind you with the reminder that we together being reminding each other today or over the past few days? Who are your friends? Are these people who will take you to dars, pray jama'ah together, remind you with the hereafter and the akhirah and jannah and nar? Or just a friend because you get on well together? Yeah, they have nice laugh and chat together. That's it. That's why they are your friends. Have you tried to avoid a lot or excessive joking and laughing? I'm not saying not to laugh or not to joke, but we exceed the boundaries. Have you ever cried out of fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Have you ever? Because if you do it once in your life, you will not touch the fire. عَيْنٌ بَكَتْ مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. An eye that was wet out of fear of Allah. If you have done it once in your life, this means you are dear to Allah. He will not torture you in the fire. But to reach that status that you can cry out of fearing Allah, it wouldn't just happen. It will happen to those who recite Quran a lot, who understand what they are reciting, those who remember Akhirah a lot, yeah? Those who make a lot of dhikr and close to Allah, then it will happen to them even once in their life and can be saved from the fire. Can you do something about it now? Can you prepare for it and to reach that stage or that level at some stage? Do you do the morning dhikr and the evening dhikr? Do you know what the morning dhikr and the evening dhikr are in the first place? And if you know them, do you do them every day or most of the days? Asbahna wa asbah al-mulku lillah, amsayna wa amsa al-mulku lillah, etc. Do you know this adhkar? Did you seek forgiveness of Allah today? Did you say astaghfirullah al-azim today? Have you? Every day you should say astaghfirullah al-azim. Once, twice, 3 times, 4 times. Yeah, it is part of the morning and the evening dhikr. If you say the morning dhikr, you have made istighfar. Have you ever made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you steadfast on his deen and to die as Muslim? Even the Prophet Yusuf, peace be upon him, what was his dua? What was the dua of the Prophet Yusuf when he met his father and mother and children and brothers back, when they met back? توفني مسلما وألحقني بالصالحين. توفني, make me die as Muslim. This is the dua of the Prophet. Have you ever made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you die as Muslim? To die on shahada? A shaitan doesn't trick you at the time of death. Do you know that at the time of death, a shaitan comes to you? Actually, a shaitan at the time of death comes to everyone. And he says to his assistant, this is your last opportunity to get him. If you miss him today, you will have no authority over him after today. Sah? When you die, الشيطان خلاص has nothing to do with you. الشيطان work with you as long as you are alive. Once you die, خلاص. Imagine this is the last chance for a shaitan to get you. Imagine how aggressive he is. How aggressive are his assistants. Oh, how weak you are at the time of death. Yeah, many people, at the time they die, they have intensive care, treatment, or cancer, whatever. Yeah, some people don't, but some people are. They are very weak. Shaitan is very aggressive. And it was narrated in many athar that a shaitan comes to in the shape of people whom you love, in the shape of your father, in the image of your mother, in the image of your sheikh that you respect. Until you die as Jew, die as Christian, die as whatever. And imagine if someone is not alert, is not aware. He spent his life just, you know, praying the prayer that is a physical, up and down in 2 minutes and finish. Next. Yeah? Will he be supported? Will he have the energy and power and the iman to respond to a shaitan and turn him away? It was narrated that Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal radiallahu anhu, at the time of death, people around him realized that he is dying. So they told him, someone told him, Imam, say La ilaha illallah. He said no. He said no. Another one told him, say La ilaha illallah. He said no. Then he woke up. He was just sort of like fainted. Said, people surprised Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Ahli Sunnah, the greatest Imam of his time. He said, we told you to say La ilaha illallah. You said, no. He said, no, I didn't listen to you. But I found a shaitan coming from the corner of the room in the image of my father telling me, die as Jew. I said, no. Then he came in the image of my mother from that side. He told me, die as Christian. I said, no. But he is Imam Ahmad, he was supported. We wish that he was supported, inshallah, alhamdulillah. Yeah, but what when a shaitan tried to trick you, he wouldn't leave you until your soul leaves the body. He will still be working with you. If you have been victorious over him all your life, you expect, inshallah, to be victorious over him in this moment. But if he used to take advantage of you all your life, don't expect suddenly that you will win with him at this moment when you are weak and he is very aggressive. So you can measure it. How often a shaitan trick you and you follow him? If most of the time, then that's what's going to happen. Do you take advantage, brothers and sisters, to sa'atul ijaba? There are times when Allah responds to the dua. Like, for example, on Friday, there is an hour Allah responds to the dua. Likely, it is between Asr and Maghrib, for example. Yeah, there are many, like the last part of the night, for example, and many other times, Laylatul Qadr. Yeah, the first 10 days of the Hijjah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you go to make Umrah or Hajj, these are the places and times where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept dua. Do you take advantage of these times? On Friday, every week, opportunity every week, or every day in the last part of the night before Fajr, and make dua to Allah to support you in this life and in the hereafter. Do you do that? Have you ever spent money to buy a book, Islamic book, to read and know about your deen? Or you spend the money everywhere and you buy extra time on the phone or something, what you call it, extra time for the internet. You pay happily. You pay £10 to give you however, whatever number of gigabyte extra times, or you go to have a meal with your friends, whatever. You pay, and you pay happily. And you save money and work and save to go for your holiday. Have you ever thought that every month or every other month or twice a year you buy a book or two of your choice to read, to increase your knowledge about the deen? Have you ever made istighfar to the believers, men and women? Because one day you will be one of them and people make istighfar for you. So why you don't make istighfar for them now? Have you ever, I'll tell you something else. Have you ever praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you are born as Muslim? Have you thought of it? The one who appreciate it are the people who spend 30 years, 40, 50, Rujay Jarudi 70 years seeking for the truth until they became Muslim. And many of them may die before they find the truth. You got it as a gift, on a silver plate, as we say. You were born as Muslim. La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah from day one has been said in your ears when you came out of your mother's tummy. What a gift. Without any effort from you. Just it's a bounty of Allah on you that you are born on Tawheed from day one. You didn't have to make any effort. I'm sure you have seen many Muslims revert and they tell you their stories. How tough was it? And many people missed it, but you got it easily. Did you praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this? Do you praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for your hearing, your seeing, your heart, your lung that is working without any effort from you, your stomach digesting the food without any input from you? Brothers, imagine, the air that you breathe in and out for free, if it is in the hand of another man or the government, he will pay tax to be able to have inspiration and expiration, I'm telling you. And some people, like people who can't afford the bill of the heating, and they spend the weather, yeah, putting all the clothes that they have because they can't switch it on because they can't afford it. Imagine if they control your breathing. Allah give it you for free. Did you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this? Yeah, it was narrated in hadith that a man on the resurrection day worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for many years, for 70 years. Without committing sins. He comes on the resurrection day and Allah commanded the angels to weigh his good deeds. So they put the good deeds on the scale, hardly any bad deeds. The scale will be too heavy on the right side where, or on the side where his good deeds are. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the angels, take him to Al-Jannah by my mercy. So the man says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my Lord, by my actions. He wants to say, look at the scale. Look. The good deeds, so far outweigh. There is no hardly any bad deeds for 70 years. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say to the angels, take him to Al-Jannah by my mercy. He says the same, and for the third time. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he review Allah for the third time, Allah asked the angels to put on the other side of the scale the bounty of seeing the vision. Give you two eyes to see on the other side. It outweighed all the good deeds. Is it fair?
Yes.
Because you can use your eyes 24 hours a day. Yeah, the fair thing that you should praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 24 hours a day as long as you are using your eyes, then becomes level. Sah? Your worship equal to Allah's bounty. Is anyone able to do this? Of us, anyone able to do this? What is the answer? No. Fine. Assuming someone is a hero and he will do it, he will still go to the fire. Because he didn't thank Allah for this, for the hearing. He didn't thank Allah for the brain. He didn't have time to thank Allah for the heart. Therefore, the Prophet ﷺ said it clearly. No one enter Al-Jannah by his actions. They said, even you, he said, even me. Except if Allah bestow his mercy on me. Did you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this? Did you give it charity on a regular basis? Do you abandon getting angry for your own sake? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam never been angry for his own sake. He gets angry when he sees the truth is attacked or the falsehood is getting higher. He gets angry only for the sake of Allah. Have you been ever avoided the haughtiness or arrogance? Did you come across a situation where you like told someone, for example, do you know who am I? How are you daring to talk to me like this, for example? Did you have that feeling that you told someone who has been arrogant to you, so you give it back and say, you know, who am I? Yeah? Who are you to talk to me like this? Did you have that arrogance once in your heart? If you had it once in your heart and you didn't repent, you'll go to the fire. Do you know that? Because no one with atom weight of arrogance will enter Al-Jannah. That's what the Prophet said. Have you purified your heart from that arrogance? From that pride that you think you may be better than X or Y or Z, even if the lowest person you meet or the youngest. Do you ever feel that you are better than someone else? It is catastrophe if you have that feeling, that you think you are better than anyone in anything, man or woman, big or small, rich or poor. You shouldn't. Have you repented from this? Have you asked Allah to purify your heart from haughtiness? Do you visit someone for the sake of Allah? Or just you meet your friends or family out of habits because you get on well together? Have you specifically visited another brother just for the sake of Allah alone? Because you love him for the sake of Allah. He reminds you is Allah, so you want to visit him out of love and brotherhood or sisterhood. Have you? Do it every now and then to save yourself in the grave. Are you obedient to your parents? Yeah? Are you upsetting your parents? When you are face a catastrophe, will you say the dua of the Prophet, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un"? We belong to Allah, and to whom we shall return. You accept it and say the dua. Do you seek refuge of Adab al-Qabr? Yeah, do you do that? Well, I mentioned to you the dua that we say before taslim in prayer. Last thing before you say assalamu alaykum, assalamu alaykum. You say dua, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min azab al-qabr wa min azab al-nar wa min fitnat al-mahya wal-mamat wa min fitnat al-masih al-dajjal. Allahumma, I seek your refuge from the torture in the grave and the torment of the fire and the fitna of the living and death and the fitna of al-dajjal. Say it every prayer. So Allah may save you and save us, inshallah, all from the torture in the grave. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our grave as part of the garden, inshallah, and not a trench of the fire, even for a moment, inshallah. And jazakumullah khayran for listening. Any question about the life in the barrier? Right? Jazakum Allah khairan. I think we'll defer the start. I was planning to start today the Resurrection Day series, but inshallah we spent 1 hour today, so this should be enough for today. And tomorrow, inshallah, the same time after Asr, over the next 4 days until the end of Ramadan, we'll cover all the information that we need to know about Yawm al-Qiyamah, the Resurrection Day. It will be a long series, inshallah. May take 5 sessions, inshallah. And jazakum Allah khairan for good listening.